guest. Hi, I'm Renee Habs. Thanks for joining me today. Our slides were working fine a few minutes ago, but now maybe not. Here we go, the global information ecosystem. Of course, we're really aware that the global ecosystem is full of clickbait, sponsored content, satire and hoaxes, partisan messages and conspiracy theories, and of course, fake news. This chart comes from the European Association of Viewer Interests, and it's one of the most powerful teaching tools we have for high school students to introduce them to the new vocabulary of messages in our information ecosystem. Of course, today we're going to be addressing the factors that may help solve the problem of misinformation. So I'm sure we're going to be exploring press freedom and quality journalism and fact-checking and digital tools and platform algorithms and law enforcement and regulation and research and civil society. And at the very bottom is always education. But that's what I'm going to focus on today. The title of my talk is Everything You Need to Counter Misinformation Can Be Learned in Kindergarten. The slides for my talk are available here at the URL listed, as well as all the materials that I'm going to be showing you today. Please raise your hand if you are a parent. Do we have any parents in the audience? Okay, wonderful. I'm so glad you're here. Let's explore. So the title is a play on a book from long ago called All I Really Need to Know I Learned in Kindergarten. And this book had some insight on how important social and emotional and cognitive competencies are all learned before a child goes to school. Of course, I'm drawing on my work in the book titled Discovering Media Literacy, Teaching Digital Media and Popular Culture in Elementary School, which I wrote with my co-author David Cooper Moore. Here I'm defining media literacy as an expanded conceptualization of literacy. When we think of literacy, we think of reading and writing, but literacy is really the sharing of meaning through symbols. And so that process involves accessing, analyzing, creating, reflecting, and taking action using a wide variety of forms. I want to talk about what I consider to be the most successful grassroots media literacy program in Eastern Europe. And I was very proud to be a partner on this program, so I want to share with you some of my experience with this incredible program. We can learn about it from this short video.
Started with our students of the University of Zagreb.
In the 21st century, then join us and become one of our partners from the European Union.
So the among the many activities that the Association for Media and Culture in Croatia developed was this project that I assisted in working on in 2015 called Media Literacy for Elementary Teachers. I'm going to be sharing with you some of the work that we did in this project. With my colleague Igor Kanija at the University of Zagreb, we developed a week-long intensive program for elementary school teachers. They ranged in age from 25 to 55, right? And where we started was with simple questions, because these were teachers who did not know what media literacy was and did not understand its relevance to elementary education. So we started with the basics. What does it look like in the classroom? Why is it important? What do students actually learn when they do media literacy? And what role do teachers play? So one distinctive characteristic of the program was it was focused on a discussion-based professional development, where there were hands-on, minds-on learning experiences. As teachers used their powerful technology devices, their cell phones, to learn how to analyze and create media. I'm going to show you some of the activities that teachers participated in during the week. Of course, exploring the whole nature of what is media, and thinking about our complex love-hate relationship with print, visual, sound, and digital media. Before teachers can even begin this work in the classroom, they must reflect deeply on their own ideological stance toward these media forms, as those attitudes and beliefs will shape their practice. Of course, then we got a chance to dig into the topic of propaganda. In 2015, I created this crowdsourced gallery of contemporary global propaganda. You can access it at mindovermedia.eu. There are over 1,700 examples of propaganda from all over the world. It's crowdsourced, so anyone from anywhere in the world can upload an example of propaganda, explain why they think it is propaganda. Becomes a very useful gallery for work in the classroom. We also looked at how introduction to media literacy can happen with very young children, even in kindergarten, right? Because all 5- and 6-year-olds should understand that media messages may be designed to persuade, to inform, and to entertain, and that often a blend of those purposes are embedded in any one message. For example, the yogurt container. Children can learn to recognize which elements of the container contain information, which elements of the container contain entertainment, which elements of the container contain persuasion. Children can recognize how persuasion and information and entertainment are blurred in many aspects of our culture today, including our consumer culture. So, here's a teacher who's critically, a group of teachers who's critically analyzing a cell phone or a telecom company ad. Is a fundamental pedagogy of media literacy. So some key ideas that teachers learned were that children need to practice to learn how to recognize how messages are designed to inform, to entertain, and persuade. And consumer culture, teachers learn, is an ideology that operates from cradle to grave, and that advertising funds most media institutions. And teachers learn that media messages use many techniques to appeal to our identity and our emotions. And they learn that through asking questions, children develop critical thinking skills about news, advertising, and social media, so that the pedagogy of eliciting children in the process of asking questions is what it's all about. Teachers also got the chance to be media makers themselves. They made a TV talk show about media literacy. They made a short narrative film. So they recognized that media analysis and production activities can happen in low-tech or in high-tech ways. Because in many elementary schools in Croatia, technology is not available, right? The internet and a data projector, not part of the elementary school classroom. But we learned how media literacy can be done with no technology at all. We also learned that when learners create media, they appreciate how carefully messages are constructed and how deadline pressures can affect quality. They also learned that media literacy doesn't have to be a separate subject. It can be integrated right into the elementary school curriculum. And they recognized how the activities of media literacy promote intellectual curiosity and high levels of engagement and learning. I would argue to you that the most significant potential benefit to media literacy is its capacity to promote intellectual curiosity. That seems to be the driver that opens up a world of competencies. Now, I want to conclude by inviting the hackers in the room to think with me. So we're raising the ideal, open-minded child. Now we just need to change the world so she can survive in it. Many of us as parents feel this way. What do we do to help our child manage in this messed up world? Well, imagine, if you will, how we might create digital games and activities for play and learning to help children recognize different media genres, to help children recognize the author's purpose and target audiences, to help children interpret messages actively, not passively, to help children recognize and resist emotional appeals, to help children spot stereotypes. I can imagine all kinds of fun learning games that would build the bedrock competencies of media literacy in very young children. Can we imagine a game that would help children notice omissions and spot inaccuracies? Can we help children distinguish between fact, fiction, and opinions, the difference between ads, blogs, news reports, and other media? Can we help children recognize what a source is and how to use sources and how to evaluate sources? Can we help students make responsible decisions about online sharing? It turns out that as students experience the power of being a journalist, being a media maker, they learn all kinds of valuable lessons. We've got a long literature in the history of media literacy research that shows when students create media, they learn how media construct reality. And that insight shouldn't wait until you get to high school or college. You should start to learn that when you're little. The five critical concepts of media literacy can be a guide toward developing the platforms that we need today. Recognizing that media are representations, not reality. That people interpret media messages differently based on their life experience and cultural background. That messages have economic and political power. That messages use different codes and conventions depending on the genre or form. And of course, most importantly, that messages influence attitudes and behaviors. These five critical concepts of media literacy should guide the development of learning games and platforms that help teachers in the Ukraine and across Eastern Europe and across Western Europe and around the world to develop these competencies in early childhood. Perhaps you'll help to develop a media literacy smartphone. Wouldn't that be cool? In any case, I would suggest to you that the best long-term strategy to address the problem of misinformation is preparing our children through the process of learning. Thanks very much.